Hello, anatomy colleagues. This is Dr. Alsup, and I am super excited to talk about the muscles of the superficial back. There are really two dominant muscles of the superficial back, and they are dominant mainly because of their size. They're very, very large and expansive muscle bellies. And these are the trapezius as well as the latissimus dorsi muscles. And you may have heard these abbreviated as your lats and your traps. So let's start with the more superior set, the trapezius muscles, which really looks like one muscle, but there is a right and a left muscle. You can kind of see where they have a separation here around the spinous processes. And as I mentioned, these are extremely expansive muscles, as you can see. In terms of proximal attachments, that's where I really think the expanse comes in. These muscles will attach all the way up on the occipital bone. This is your occipital bone here. At the external occipital protuberance, which is kind of in the midline. So if you palpate the back of your own head, you will likely feel a bump back there, and that is the external occipital protuberance. And there will be a line of bone extending laterally from either side of the external occipital protuberance, and that's called the superior nuchal line. So that is going to be the superior-most attachment. The more inferior attachments include the ligamentum nuchae, sometimes referred to as the nuchal ligament, which you can see in this smaller image here. And this is really extending from the external occipital protuberance to some of those spinous processes of the cervical region. And it's really serving as a bridge, bridging the gap of those deeper and shorter cervical vertebrae. So you will have the trapezius attaching there, and you will have the extension of the more proximal attachments even past this nuchal line all the way to some of the spinous processes, all the way down to oftentimes the thoracic vertebrae number 12. So a fairly extensive and long proximal attachments. The distal attachments are on the clavicle as well as the scapula, meaning these muscles will cross the scapulothoracic joint. Recall our discussions on the scapulothoracic joint from the last session. It is not a typical synovial joint, but instead this joint, which we kind of have in quotation marks, is really describing the movements of the scapula on the thoracic cage. So really helping to better facilitate a full range of motion at that neighboring shoulder joint. Also of note, we're going to focus on the primary movements possible at the scapula, but the trapezius muscles can assist in the movement of some of the intervertebral joints as well. And lastly, before I move off this slide, I do want to point out there are three main directions of muscle fibers in the trapezius. There are the superior, oftentimes referred to as descending fibers, the middle part, and then the inferior or ascending fibers of the trapezius. So you'll often see them divided in these three ways. And dependent on which fibers are contracting, this can greatly affect the actions that can occur. So if all fibers are contracting in unison, with that middle part playing the biggest role, there can be retraction of the scapula, or kind of that posterior medial movement of the scapula, kind of moving back into place. Think about bringing the medial portions of your scapula together. Dependent on whether the ascending or descending fibers are contracting independently, the trapezius can actually be antagonistic to itself. So with the ascending fibers, this can lead to depression of the scapula, all right, as you can kind of see moving down, or the descending fibers will elevate the scapula. And if these ascending and descending fibers contract together, but not so much those middle fibers, there can be upward or superior rotation of that glenoid fossa or glenoid cavity of the scapula. And as you can see in this illustration, this can really lend to that full range of abduction or flexion in the shoulder joint. The trapezius is similar to the sternocleidomastoid muscle in that it has separate afferent and efferent innervation, as it is also efferently innervated by the accessory nerve, or the cranial nerve 11, similar to the SEM, or sternocleidomastoid. And as we recall, accessory nerve is solely efferent. The afferent innervation will derive from fibers of cervical spinal nerves C3 and C4. You can see some C2 and C3 branches. C4 would just be a little bit lower. And you can really see in this image the accessory nerve extending between that reflected sternocleidomastoid heading to the trapezius. So kind of hitting its two main targets there. Okay, moving on to the latissimus dorsi muscle, which, similar to the trapezius, is a very expansive muscle, but with a few important differences. One important one is that it is notably inferior. So the trapezius would be up in this region, whereas the latissimus is going to be more inferiorly located, with proximal attachments additionally on those thoracic spinous processes, but also in terms of some ribs, and it will even extend all the way to the iliac crest. So if you kind of think putting your hands on your hips, you're touching your iliac crest, so you have this muscle extending all the way down to that region. Another important proximal attachment is this area called the thoracolumbar fascia, which you can't really see here in this illustration, but it's visible on this one. The thoracolumbar fascia is going to be quite a dominant structure on the inferior back, and if you're one of the individuals dissecting, this will be something that is clearly visible. Basically, in a superficial view, if you aren't looking at the latissimus dorsi in this inferior region, you are looking at this shiny thoracolumbar fascia. And this fascia covers and envelops many of the deep back muscles in this region, so a fairly thick, robust structure. The other major difference with the latissimus dorsi to the trapezius is that its distal attachment is actually on the humerus, specifically on the floor of the intertubercular sulcus. I would put this a little bit higher. I think this is a little on the low side. So this will mean that it's actually crossing the glenohumeral or the shoulder joint, so it will directly affect these motions or the movements capable at this joint. Specifically, the latissimus dorsi will play a large role in extension, or kind of pulling back, it's kind of pulling back from a flex position, moving kind of more back into anatomical position, or pulling the arm back more posteriorly. With adduction, this would be bringing back towards anatomical position or more medially, and also plays a role in terms of medial or internal rotation, so that anterior portion of the humerus will rotate or face more medially. And if you are having a hard time conceptualizing these movements, you can check out some videos showing someone actually acting out these movements if you click on this link here. So these can be very powerful movements, and we actually use these quite a bit in the actions of climbing or paddling a canoe, or specific swim strokes, and these can be very powerful contractions to allow for these movements to occur. The thoracodorsal nerve will provide both the afferent and efferent innervation of this muscle, and this is a branch of the brachial plexus, which is a lovely thing that we are going to spend ever so much time with during the musculoskeletal content later on in this year. So no worries about memorizing this chart quite yet, but know that it is coming in your future. But kind of across the board, if a muscle is associated with the upper limb, it almost always is going to be innervated by a nerve branch of this brachial plexus, with a very few exceptions. And so that is true of the thoracodorsal from this posterior cord of the brachial plexus. One important clinical correlation that both of these muscles share are that they are boundaries of the triangle of auscultation, which is located laterally at the medial border of the scapula. Sometimes the lateral border is described as the rhomboid major muscle, which is attached on that medial border of the scapula, so basically the same area there. Medially, the border will be the trapezius, specifically those ascending fibers, and then inferiorly, that superior border of the latissimus dorsi muscle. And all three of these structures are palpable, and when you kind of connect those dots, as you can see here, these dashes, you get this triangle of auscultation. I also want to note on this image that because the scapula is a bit kind of overly protracted, it actually makes the space appear a little bit bigger than it actually is, but it's kind of more what you would have if a scapula is protracted. Now, why would we make up this imaginary triangle and have you memorize its boundaries? Not because we're mean, but because this is going to be useful to you as a future clinician. It is here that you can really optimally auscultate many lung sounds, particularly in the inferior lobes of the lungs, or during a pulmonary examination in general. Particularly when a patient kind of crosses their arms across their chest, they will really retract that scapula, kind of similar to what you see here, allowing for fewer things in between or structures between the stethoscope and the lungs. So these muscles not only lead to important actions associated with the scapular and thoracic joints, but really form important palpable boundaries for some routine clinical examinations. And now we have come to the end. I hope you've had as much fun as I did talking about the muscles of the superficial back. Here, as always, is the summary slide for this learning objective. And these are these big picture concepts that I hope you take away from this learning objective. As always, if you have any follow-up questions, please feel free to reach out to me or any of my anatomy colleagues. We are always ever so excited to talk about anatomy. Thank you for your time and attention, and have a great day.